Okay, folks, I think we're going to start. We're getting up to numbers now. So welcome to our free webinar, Bamburgh Castle Digs, Dirt and Discoveries. Hopefully you can all see my screen at the moment. Graham and I are going to flip between the two. But before we start, I'm just going to give you an outline of what we're going to do. And maybe an introduction to Graham and myself. So there'll be a quick intro to the Bamburgh Research Project. Hopefully most of you have heard of us. We're based at the Bamburgh Castle on Northumberland Coast. Graham's going to give you an overview of the Bolehole Cemetery, which is an early medieval cemetery just in the dunes outside the castle. We're going to have a very brief tour of the Bamburgh Bones Digital Ossuary, and I will explain more about that later. And then there will be an intro to the Hope Taylor years, and I'll let Graham explain that a little bit more. And then we'll look at the excavations that's been taking place in the inner and west ward of Bamburgh Castle, and we'll let you know about our most recent discovery, which is very exciting. And then I'm going to take you on a little tour of artifacts from the excavation. And just to give you some sense of how many we've got 12,000 plus small finds, and literally rooms and rooms full of bulk finds. I've spent the morning distilling them down into our top 10, and we'll finish with a Q&A. A little bit of housekeeping before we go on to that. Please keep yourself on mute, just so we can focus on what we're doing today. There is a Q&A function enabled, so you can ask us some questions, and Graham and I will answer them as we go, and we'll try and bring any of the really pertinent questions to the audience. The chat feature is enabled, so if there are any issues or anything you want to talk about in terms of the tech, let me know and I'll try and fix that for you. Towards the very end, we are going to use the polls feature, so I hope you participate in that. And probably the most important bit of the housekeeping, we will be looking at skeletal remains during a portion of this, and we'll give you a heads up just before we start that, and you can log back in if you wish. So I am going to stop my screen share and hopefully head over to Graham.
Excellent. Well, obviously, if everyone can see it, it's just a little location map for our corner of Northumberland with Bamburgh Bay and such like. If anyone's not familiar with Bamburgh, it's very worthwhile having a little Google for some spectacular photographs. Basically, Bamburgh Castle sits on a rock outcrop sticking out just in front of the beach. It's a very spectacular setting, and it's probably no surprise really that it's been an occupied site for generations and generations. One of the first areas we actually looked for when we started the research project many, many years ago was the burial ground. And it had been known to exist for quite some time. There was a great storm in the winter of 1817. It blew away a huge volume of sand. And a series of what are called kist burials were seen, which are basically stone slabs outlining graves. And so the existence of a burial ground close to the castle gate, about 300 metres to the south, been known for a very long time. It was investigated by antiquarians, and despite the fact that its location was marked on the first edition Ordnance Survey map, by the middle of the 20th century, people seem to have forgotten where it was. So Brian...
Yeah. Sorry, can I just interrupt you? Can you expand your screen just to make it a little bit bigger for people to see?
Okay. Well, if I put it on slideshow, would that work?
Do you think? Yeah, that'd be fine. Okay. And we do have a question asking if they can actually see you as well.
See if it works. Yeah.
Yeah, that's much better. Oh, and there you are.
Okay. Hello. A cat may join us at some moment, but don't be alarmed. So obviously we've been looking at, oh, I think my computer's having a go slow at the moment. Hopefully we'll get another slide in them. No? Come on. Ah, there we go. Yeah, it's just having a bit of a, I'll get back to the right slide in just a moment. And one more, perhaps. Come on. Yeah, I think the problem with older computers, they do get frustrated by running too many programs. Anyway, here we are. We're back at the right side. This is basically the LiDAR coverage of the village. We've got a nice big red dot showing us where the burial ground lies. And as I was saying, despite the fact that the cemetery site was known and actually is sort of marked on the first edition Ordnance Survey, when Brian Hope Taylor, who we'll hear about later, was trying to rediscover it. He looked everywhere but. And the reason is it's such an odd place. It doesn't seem like a burial ground should be there. It's right at the base of a slope next to the dune field. And it's only when we started to investigate the coastline itself that it made sense as a burial ground, because the coastline, as you see today, has changed enormously. So when we tried to approximate what a medieval coastline would look like, we get a high tide that comes up almost to the base of the rock, and the burial ground itself becomes a plateau overlying a tidal beach. So it becomes basically a coastal burial ground, perhaps associated with a road that was going south from the castle. So the landscape has changed enormously since the time when the burial ground was in use. This expanse of water in the middle here is the bowl hole itself, which is basically just a giant low-lying depression in the dune field that floods in the winter time. And you can just start to make out in bright blue there the areas of the actual excavation on this peninsular area at the base of the slope. And this is basically a nice schematic of the burials themselves. Because it's an area of special scientific interest, we were only allowed to open up a very limited area per season. So basically the excavation, as you see drawn in one lump, is done in little packets each year at a time from about 2002 to 2007. This was the last one here. And if you start looking at the scale of the slope and the density of the burials and the limits as we understand them, we're probably looking at a burial ground that could have contained between about 500 and 1,000 people. And we don't really know how much further to the south it goes, so it could be bigger and go on for longer periods than we know at the moment. The burial ground itself, obviously, we heard about the kist burials. This is one of them here. If you can see the cursor, it goes. You can see that the mottled fill of the grave on the inside, there's actually some bone from a disturbed skeleton that's been tucked away in the corner. And you can see these stone slabs that start to outline the grave. Now, normal kists are completely outlined in stone, but the ones that we excavated turned out to be only partially lined. And in fact, only about 1 in 5 of the graves has any form of stone lining at all. So it's quite a mixed, varied cemetery that we've discovered here. And that goes for the burials themselves. This is one of the I suppose, more photogenic burials. It's a crouched burial, very like a number of burials are in the prehistoric period. But we have all sorts of different ways of laying out a skeleton in the grave. They're mostly west-east in terms of orientation, but we do kind of get them opposite way around. Some of the graves are intercutting, but in the main, the cemetery seems to have been reasonably well managed. So we do have some obvious laid out rows in various places. And we have an unusual number of burials that are buried face down. And I don't think this is accidental. I'm sure this is probably a deliberate practice. And so we also have these very crouched burials as well. So there's a lot of different things. And I suspect that the people who are laying their bereaved in the soil were perhaps trying to say about these variations. And only some of them we probably even begin to understand. It's not a burial ground that produces lots of grave goods. We'll find out in a moment when we have a quick look at the radiocarbon dates that it's an early medieval cemetery site. But you find the odd little artifact with them, and they're mostly sort of everyday items, a knife and buckle, something that would have been attached to a belt, for instance. And here we see one of a very spectacular comb with very few teeth left on it. So we're looking at little personal items. What we don't see are princely burials, you know, that you see Sutton Hoo is the most classic example, but others that contain weapon burials and high status items. We don't see that. And when we look at the radiocarbon dates, they'll span from about the 6th century through to the 9th century. We think when we look at the grave goods, the radiocarbon dates, and all of the other evidence that we have, we're almost certainly looking at a 7th, 8th century cemetery site, probably starting off closer to the castle with the earlier burials. And as you pass through time, we're going south away from the castle. So that makes a certain logic, and it's sort of borne out in the radiocarbon dates. Though obviously they span such a substantial amount of time, that you get to, you can only see it sort of as a gradual effect. We have 91 discrete individuals. When you add up and look at all of the bone assemblage, including the disturbed material, there clearly are well over 100 individuals represented in the excavation archive itself. But obviously you can see that we actually did quite a substantial representation of the cemetery site. And we've got a fairly even mix between male and females, as far as we can tell. And 31% are non-adults as well. And so we basically have everything from the neonates, you know, early born babies, right through to very elderly people. So we're looking here at full family groups, which is fascinating in and of itself. And obviously one of the principal things that the post-ex conducted by Durham University did was to look at the skeletons and what they can tell us about disease and such like, only some of which obviously are represented in the skeletons. But we have, and we'll see a couple of gruesome photographs, I'll warn you beforehand, they have terrible teeth, but otherwise they're actually quite robust, quite big, quite healthy people. But because you're looking at a variety of ages and some of them live quite elderly, we do see evidence of osteoarthritis, of gout and various other diseases that do mark the skeleton. And there's a couple of instances of weapon trauma, but not a great deal. But that's not surprising because, you know, it's an early medieval cemetery site and we're right at the heart of the Kingdom of Northumbria, and war and such like tends to be undertaken towards the edges and the periphery of the kingdom. This is some of the dental disease that we've seen. A really frightening number of people have abscesses and such like. So I think Sarah, who did the principal work on the skeletons, described them as the most terrible set of teeth she'd ever seen. Of people who are otherwise very robust, very well fed, very healthy, they have just terrible dental hygiene. And one of our little pet theories, certainly my pet theory, is that because we think that this cemetery site is associated with the fortress, the palace site, we may be looking at the effects of a great deal of mead and high living on the actual bodies themselves, which is fascinating. But yeah, it is one of the more gruesome aspects of dealing with human remains, tooth abscesses. They do tend to make you cringe a little bit. Now we can measure the sort of the height, we can get age estimates, we can usually get sex estimates for adults, produce statistics like that, and we can see some diseases that affect the bodies that survive in the skeletons themselves. And normally, of course, that's where a cemetery excavation ends in terms of what you can tell about the individuals. But in the last 20 or so years, there's been quite a revolution in the science that we can do. And we were very fortunate in that our excavation was timed just perfectly for the arrival of isotope analysis on skeletal remains. So this is conducted using the teeth. Obviously the whole of the skeleton is affected by what we eat and drink, but the teeth are really good because they're sealed under the enamel, and they're a very robust sample. So you don't get water washing material through them. And what we were able to do is, for every individual where the skeleton had teeth surviving, we were able to do analysis of strontium and oxygen isotopes. Now this is fascinating science. I won't go into the great detail on it, but basically the basic principle is that you are what you eat, and your skeleton is formed from the food that you consume and from the water that you drink. This is a map of the strontium isotope ratios in the British, in mainland Britain. And you can see the British Isles are a very geographically varied landscape, from, you know, ancient volcanic geology up in the Scottish Highlands down to the chalk of the English lowlands. So when crops grow on soil, the soil is derived in no small part from the rocks that lie beneath them. And so crops actually have a signature with these strontium isotopes based on the underlying geology. So it's a little bit like an XY plot on a map. And also we sampled for oxygen 16, oxygen 18 isotopes. And this is a temperature proxy. This tells us the broad temperature range of the water that you're consuming. You would normally expect it to go sort of cold north, hot south. You can see there's a map of the oxygen ratios of Europe. And that bears it out. Scandinavia and into Russia, an area looks like cold, and sub-Saharan Africa, very, very hot. But the British Isles are tilted on their side in an odd way by the Gulf Stream. So we get the hot signatures along the west coast here and the coldest ones sort of in the central highlands of Scotland. So between those two isotopes, we get a sort of strange XY plot, which gives us a very broad idea of the places where people grew up in, during the bone forming years of sort of prenatal and early childhood. And this is the distribution plot of all of our results. And very quickly, here we've got the oxygen ratio. So this is the normal oxygen ratio for our little corner of Northumberland at Bamburgh. And this is the strontium ratio. And where the two overlap, that gives us a good indication that those people grew up as children in and around Bamburgh. And as you can see, there are very, very few. So it's an unusual cemetery site in that almost everyone seems to be from somewhere else. There's some here where we obviously were much colder, but most seem to come from slightly warmer areas, so probably slightly to the south or to the west of Northumberland. And one or two outliers are from very warm areas indeed. And that really is fascinating. So we're looking at people who are drawn from around the British Isles. We do have what seems to be a strong contingent from perhaps Ireland or the west coast of Scotland, but we most particularly have very cold Scandinavian time signatures, which are people who are coming to Bamburgh from abroad. And we also have Mediterranean hot signatures of a group, and they actually do group together. And a lot of these very exotic isotope signatures are also amongst our burials that are buried face down, very prone. So the archaeology seems to map the science in this regard. So we don't think that this is an anomaly. We think this is a genuine picture of what is a very cosmopolitan 7th, 8th century community that's arriving from all over the British Isles and even wider Europe to Bamburgh. And so if anything has sort of shocked us in our researches at Bamburgh, I think it's the scale of just how far reaching these connections are. And at that point, I think I've probably done my bowl hole bit, and I will pass back to my colleague for the next phase.
Sure. So while Graham pops out of screen sharing, if you have any questions, can you put them in the Q&A, and hopefully Graham can answer those just as I quickly go through the next bit. I did see one question pop up there. So just bear with me 2 seconds while we get this going. So while we're on the ball hall, we wanted to highlight a newish project that we've been working on with Accessing Aidan, which is a lottery funded project led by the Northumberland AOMB. And we have been particularly involved in part of the project called the Bamburgh Bones. And this has utilised the excavation material from the ball hall and the research that we undertook with Durham University to create what is a brilliant public outreach resource. And it's called the Digital Ossuary. And you can see this is the website page here, and I will put this in the chat at a later date. But what it does, it allows you to actually go into the Digital Ossuary, and we'll have a quick look in a moment, and actually explore the cemetery site. And you can look at the various bits of data that Graham has been talking by skeletal assemblage or by individual skeleton or burial. So just bear with me a sec and I'll come back to this. Stop share for a second and go into the different bit. Oh, we're jumping ahead here. It's always dangerous. Bear with me. Sorry, I'm having a really slow computer day, which is typical. So here we are. Go back to sketch share screen so you can, guys can see this. Where are we? Here we are. What can you see on your screen, Graham? So
At the moment, yes, it's just appeared. Yes.
Okay, can you see the graveyard map?
Yes.
That's reassuring. So if you come in on the Bamburgh Bones page, you'll enter, and hopefully if my computer's not being too slow, we'll be able to actually access one of the skeletal remains. So you can toggle the site, and hopefully this will look familiar to you based on Graham's images that he's just used. And each of these is an entry into a database entry. So this is the map of the site, and we can toggle the entry labels, hopefully, if it comes up. Just have to bear with my computer, I'm afraid, guys. I can hear it whirring away. Here we go. And each of the individual skeletons has been given a code name to help identify them. I'm actually going to click on this tiny one in the corner here, because this is the first skeleton that I ever excavated as an archaeologist. So I thought that would be an apt one to look at. So we'll just wait for it to load. But in this database, you know, it's a good opportunity to kind of understand the makeup of the burial site without going into the excavation reports. And on you here, you'll find out everything about the skeleton. So the age, what parts of the skeletal remains were found. And then we'll get the interpretation of the evidence. So we talk a little bit about this individual who was a 5 to 7 year old child, both with milk and adult teeth. We'll understand some of the pathology, some of the disease. For example, I believe this one had tooth decay at 5 to 7. And as Graham mentioned, this was quite common in the Bull Hole Cemetery, and indicates a high sugar intake in their diet. You can also look at some of the injuries, not on this particular one, but examples of origin, burial positions, and any artifacts. But unusually, this burial did have an artifact with it. It was a highly corroded iron buckle found between the arm bones. But we just wanted to highlight it because it gives you a really good snapshot, and it may be something that, having listened to Graham, you want to investigate a little bit more. There are photographs from the actual excavation itself. So Bamburgh 05, my first year at Bamburgh. So it's a really good resource, and it's actually award-winning. So Accessing Aidan recently won a Heritage Award for its kind of outreach work. And it's really kind of putting public archaeology and participation on the map. And thankfully, because of the funding from the lottery as well, and the Bull Hole monograph, hopefully, I'm looking at you, Graham, will be out next year, and you'll all be able to kind of look at the work in depth.
That's still very much the plan.
Okay, so I'm going to stop sharing and go back to Graham, unless we have any questions in the chat. Let's have a look. We've got some in the Q&A, Graham.
Yeah.
So we've got a question from Sue. What would these people from the southern warm places have been doing in Bamburgh?
Oh, well, that's a good question. I think when you look at the Scandinavian burials, we know that there's a lot of connections across the North Sea from trade and various other things. So perhaps that's not at all surprising. When we're looking at, you know, going as far as, say, southern Europe, even sort of the North African coastline, I think the one factor that probably connects Northumbria as far as the Mediterranean is Christianity. Well, I think that there's one of the late bishops from, I think, the 7th century is of Greek in origin. So we know that the Christian church is very cosmopolitan at this time and very widespread. It's the one institution that seems to link all of these areas together. So that's probably my best interpretation. And of course, Bamburgh Castle becomes a cult center for St. Oswald. We're probably looking at a degree of pilgrimage developing amongst the mobile elite. So that's probably my best guess at the moment.
Thanks, Graham. We have another question from Phil, and I believe you've answered it in the chat, but we might as well talk a little bit more about it. He's asked, why do you think they were face down burials?
There are a number of theories about sort of prone burials, from what I think is the implausible, which is that, you know, they weren't certain which way up someone was when they put them in the burial. That seems very haphazard. I think if you're burying someone you care about, or just with basic human decency, you're probably going to do it with a degree of care. So I think that's unlikely. My favorite idea, again, it's just one of the things you can't really prove easily, but someone once suggested that the prone burials are buried as if they're sort of lying face down in front of an altar, like in a supplicant way. And it may be a reflection of the Christian church coping with the fact that they don't know whether they've been recently confessed before burial, and if they think they've maybe been best and, you know, died in a state of sin without confession, that they bury them in these prone supplicant fashion, so that they're sort of let, you know, that it's basically a way of having confession post-death, I guess. I think that fits in with it being more common amongst the more exotic individuals who may have had difficulties with language and communication, who have come from further away. But of course, you can't dismiss the idea of superstition and not wanting spirits to rise as well. So it may be that there are many reasons why people are buried prone. and because it's such a cosmopolitan cemetery that we see more of it than you normally do as a consequence of that.
Brill, thank you. Questions are stacking up, Graham. Hope you're ready. So, one from Sylvia. Was there any difference in the health of the bones in the burials of people who originated from different locations?
Yes, when we do the longer lecture, basically the short version is, in terms of health terms, it pays not to be from Britain, and it definitely pays not to be from the north of Britain. The Mediterranean skeletons are way the healthiest, so are the Scandinavian. That's probably not shocking. If you can travel those distances, you're probably not very elderly or very ill when you set off. So the fact you made it into the burial ground says that something went wrong, at least along the way, by the time you reached Bamburgh. But yes, the dental disease, the indication of disease on the bones does seem to diminish with distance from the northeast of England. And this may be a reflection of, you know, Mediterranean or Scandinavian diets compared with old fashioned British Isles diets, going back even to this period of time. And also possibly lifestyle choices. With this feasting culture, we know from early medieval England may have been particularly prevalent and really quite bad for your long-term health outcomes.
Thank you. Next question, and people are quite interested in the sources of sugar and obviously the impact on the teeth. So Amanda's asked, what sources of sugar other than honey would have caused dental problems in a child of 4 to 5 years of age?
Well, obviously for the adults, you know, we know that it's great hall culture, it's very drinking culture. So mead is a very obvious issue with that, if it's made from honey. I'm guessing there are other foods. I think Sarah once suggested that high meat elements in the diet can be quite bad for the teeth as well. And then just general poor dental hygiene. I think at this period of time, there's not really obvious forms of sugar. I'm assuming there's sugar beets of some form, but sugar cane certainly isn't widely available. So it predates all of that. I think it may have more to do with dental hygiene for the very young individuals. It seems unlikely they're drinking a lot of mead, particularly early ages. Though I think we do have a 26-year-old with what may be a case of gout, which suggests high living from quite an early start.
Impressive. I've got a question from Sally. She said, did I understand that they were not from local areas? Yes, Stella, that's correct, or at least some of them. And she's asked, if so, could locals be buried elsewhere?
Well, again, it's one of these things we're in a very brief area, we can't discuss. The burial ground, when you stand in it, you can't see the village at all. You can look straight back into the inner ward where the church with the cult centre of Oswald would have stood, and it looks out to sea. So it seems to be connected to the fortress, the palace, and it looks out away from the land, effectively, in terms of where they've chosen to site it. And the village would have had its own church dedicated to St. Aidan. So the likelihood is the village community are buried in and around the village, just as they are today. And in fact, where the skeletons are now, in the crypt underneath St. Aidan's. I think there would have been a lot of people living in the area, working in the area, but it seems the occupation, the people in the palace itself, were often from further afield, but there would have been a burial ground in the village for the local population.
Real, thank you. And then we've got two questions from Barry. He's asked, when these people were buried, was this area at sand dunes as it is now? And if so, why would they have buried them in the dunes and not in the ground around the castle?
Well, it's very difficult to reconstruct the landscape really accurately, but we do have a number of indicators. Luckily, we had Dr. Ian Boomer, who was a coastal geomorphologist, and he worked with us in the early years. So he helped map the idea that the modern dune field has been arriving for the last few hundred years. And when you look in the archaeology in the castle itself, from the late medieval period right through to the modern period, you get vast amounts of sand blowing into the castle, the grass grows through it. So we get this deep horizon of windblown sand. But when we get back to about the 15th century and earlier, there is some sand content, but it's much lower. So we have evidence that the dune field has been arriving recently. The suggestion that the castle basically fronts onto a tidal beach, which would remain wet, washed by the sea twice a day. And the fact that sand is blowing into the castle in much smaller quantities in the Middle Ages than it was later. And this all suggests that the dry dune field is very modern. So I think the burial ground is it's dug through sand just above a tidal beach, and there's very little in the way of dune field compared to today, where it's very extensive indeed. So I think basically it's a sandy plateau at the base of a wooded slope with a, you know, a tidal beach right in front of it. It's not as it is today in the marum grass with big mounds of dune field. So I think it's changed enormously in the last few hundred years.
Thanks, Graham. And I think we've come to the end of our Q&A for the ball hall. Okay. So Graham, if you want to move on to our excavations within the castle proper.
Okay. Okay, can everyone see a very nice drone shot of the West Ward looking at the Great Keep?
Yes, looking good.
Excellent. Well, basically, this is one of the drone photographs. In the foreground, you can see the big trench of Trench 3, which I'll come to later. That's the inner ward, which I'm going to talk about. So you can see that we're in the castle itself, looking down into to the fortress. You can actually see some of the underlying bedrock outcropping in various places. So it's basically, it's a natural rock fortress that's been occupied by layer upon layer of occupation going back a very long time. 12th century keep up at the top. So this high plateau is the heart of the fortress. There's an entrance off the base of the photograph here, which we think is the early way in because it's the lowest part of the rock. And the West Ward is one of the quieter areas of the fortress that we see today. But it's very easily accessible for archaeology, whereas at the summit of the hill, obviously this is where all the major buildings still stand today, and it's where they have wedding receptions and such like. So it's not an easy place for archaeology to be done, but as you'll see, we have actually managed to do a little bit of work up there. But since Brian Hope Taylor was first involved in Bamburgh, the West Ward has been the focus of the archaeology. We know that Dr. Hope Taylor, from his own writing, came to Bamburgh because he'd been excavating at Yeavering from the Ministry of Works, and he wanted to compare his Yeavering early medieval palace site with a known very high status top tier palace site, and also I think because he was curious to work at Bamburgh. So he came, he got on very well with the late Lord Armstrong, and he excavated at Bamburgh in two seasons between 59 and 61. He was then went off, worked at York and various places, but he clearly liked what he'd seen. And he came back and he excavated from 1970 to 74. And then there was, I think, a little bit of a falling out because he never finished his excavation. And one of the more unusual aspects of our dig when we started to basically come and work at the castle is you can see built into a thick wall here, there's one, there's a second you can't quite see, a third and a fourth door leading out onto a little pathway right next to Trench 3. Trench 3 is cited because that's where Hope Taylor had dug in the 70s, which we later found out. But when we were first working there, the castle groundsman came down and burst these doors open to give us a little office space. And in these rather dank and musty rooms, we found Hope Taylor's site office, his tool store, and one of the final rooms was stacked floor to ceiling with over 100 museum box size boxes of finds. So some of the finds from the excavation. So that was a very eerie moment. This is one of the photographs I've included. It wasn't a very photogenic experience. We do have video footage of it, which is probably more interesting. This was one of his site offices. Just off screen to the left, we actually found one of the tables with a kettle sitting on it and a bottle of milk, which was thankfully empty, because it would have been quite gross, because this was, we opened this again in 2001 and they'd been shut basically in 1974. There's a lot of material and debris had rained down from the ceilings, but you can see these old school desks, and onto these they actually had small finds that they were processing basically when they finished that season. Clearly they locked up with the intention of coming back the next year, but it just never happened. And you can even see very good primary dating evidence there, a newspaper from 1974 just sitting quietly on a seat. So that was a very eerie experience of sort of almost excavating someone's site office in the past. That was the same year that Brian Hope Taylor died, which meant basically we inherited an excavation that had been started but never finished. So our original plans of doing some quite modest work in the castle turned into, well, what for me has been most of a life's work almost, which lots of people have been involved with and joined in with. We pieced together the nature of it. The blue outlines are our major trenches. This is Hope Taylor's trial trench one from 1960, the first ever hole he dug at Bamburgh. He then came back in the 1970s, opened up this open area here, which became our trench three. But he also did a series of trial trenches radiating out from the windmill mound, which later became our site offices here. So he basically wanted to get a good idea of what the archaeology of the West Ward was like. And then we have come along subsequently. We started excavating right at this top corner to avoid the more complicated parts of the archaeology so we could get an idea of what's going on without digging holes through things we weren't properly understanding. So we did two trial trenches, which turned into one open area excavation. And then later, after Hope Taylor had died, we sited a parallel dig so we could interpret and ultimately finally publish Hope Taylor's original open area excavation here. This is a photograph, a couple of them, that are currently held at the Scottish Royal Commission of his 1960 trial trench one. As you can see, these are feet rather than the meter poles we use today. But even so, that's basically the height of the person. He dug 3 meters vertically down to the bedrock. And it turns out he dug through, well over 2000 years of occupation. And when we reopened that trench and re-recorded it, the shaded areas or the bulks that he'd left in, which we dug down for samples, you can see radiocarbon dates and such like. This isn't an eye test, you won't be able to read this, but very low down in the sequence, there are Roman pottery sherds marked on the sections. And then we go through a relatively aceramic area, which is the early medieval period. And then the upper areas are medieval midden deposit. And when I was talking about windblown sand, this great series of layers here are basically yellow sand that's blown into the castle from the period of semi-abandonment in the 15th century. So we basically have an occupation which spans the prehistoric right through to the modern era, which is fascinating for any site, but very exciting. This is Hope Taylor's original open area excavation in the West Ward from the very beginning of the 1970s. He got really quite deep in places. You can also see one of his test pits that's radiating down from the windmill. So this is the area that he substantially excavated but never quite finished. So it's been the one of the biggest elements of our project since the burial ground was finished, has been following his footsteps. And one of the really fascinating little features, which I'll mention again briefly, is this strange circular feature here. This is part of his open area excavation, and it turns out to be a mortar mixer. Hope Taylor called it his gingang. And basically it's a big donut shaped hollow in the ground. There would have been a central post with paddles and an ox would have walked around, and it's basically industrial scale batch mixing of mortar for stone building work. And on the side here, you can see very limited traces. We actually have photographs of and plaster casts of the ox footprints in the soil around the mortar mixer. And here there's some stone slabs, which photographs show spilled with mortar on them. So we think this is the loading platform heading off into the ward. And he's taken a nice quadrant corner out of the mortar mixer there as a sample. But something very interesting was just out of his reach beneath the mortar mixer, which we'll come to right at the end. So before going into vast detail, this is Bamburgh Castle as it is today with a bit of contour maps around it. This is the West Ward with all of the trenches and archaeological interventions. And I'll come back and I'll do a very short little bit on our two areas of excavation. But I'll mention a little bit about the inner ward. This is the flat plateau on the very top of the hill. It's probably been the focus of the fortress from the earliest times. We know that the 12th century keep and the great hall and stuff of the high Middle Ages is up here. And we have textual reference to the church with St. Oswald's remains being up here. And a well, which is currently in the keep, which has cut through 45 meters of bedrock in order to provide water to the people living in the fortress itself. And so obviously this has been a built up area for probably 2000 years or more, but there are some areas that you can get access for archaeology. We were very fortunate that we were able to, we did ground penetrating radar survey and resistivity on the lawned areas. The main area of the lawn is turned out to be so disturbed that both the surveys and one trial trench that we did with Time Team just demonstrated it's very disturbed and there's very little left there for us to investigate. In the 12th century chapel foundations, which now have a little folly built on top of them, it's a very different story. The resistivity shows up a whole series of features. And when we were able to trial trench into this area, we find that we've got between a meter and a meter and a half of preserved archaeology in this area, which is particularly fascinating. This top one is the resistivity survey. You can see the darker is high resistance. So there were a series of high resistance anomalies, including two matching dark high resistance features here, which turn out to be the foundations of the chancel arch, something going on at this back end here. But the radar survey, when it was 3D projected, produced this very strange domed effect, which looked very like a buried crypt, which really tempted us to go and investigate. But it turned out there wasn't a crypt. That's a little spoiler. This is the two main trenches we put in. This was what, 2007? Basically just to investigate what we could actually identify within the chapel itself. And then at a later date, we were able to investigate one of the areas of there's basically a little flower border that they were placed in gravel. So we were able to do one of the world's longest and thinnest excavations all along that north side and a little bit along here on the south side of the chapel itself. There are two proper test excavations in the main body of the chapel. This is the one that's closest to the east end of the church. And you can see here, we've got a rubble foundation, a really substantial rubble foundation of a massive chancel arch. So this is high medieval church architecture from the chapel, which is probably built around the time of Henry II. But underneath it and constructed on top of this feature here, which comes back in at an odd angle compared to the later medieval church, which is the face of a wall extending into the body of the church, slightly off an east-west alignment. And when we went into the next test pit, which is right at the west end, the wall re-emerged. You can see it here. There's a giant corner coin stone, which is more than two courses high, really monumental lump of sandstone, and a right angle turn. So this wall effectively turns a right angle. You can actually see that there's this odd thing here where one of the big stone slabs has been, this big one has been etched out so this can fit into it. So it's unusual, but very substantial stone architecture. And what we've got basically are two sides of an early stone building that predate the 12th century church. So this is our first really good possibility of early medieval stone architecture at Bamburgh. And then when we excavated the sort of flower border along the other side, you can look back towards the keep. We found a very substantial wall here, which is nice ashlar chamfer course. We think it's Norman. And if you stand on it and look along it, it seems to exactly align with the 12th century keep curtain wall, which turns a bit of an angle here. So we think the inner ward has been extended out. They've infilled. They put a wall further downslope and infill behind it, so expanded the west ward at some point around the Norman period, just to create more space. So that was fascinating as well. But within that little flower border, we found that we've got lots of medieval stonework, including a large stone plateau, but again, buried into and forming part of the foundations of the 12th century church. We found two stones on a different alignment. You can see them here, that they're externally plaster rendered, and they're just buried by the 12th century foundations. But they do, when you plot them up, actually align with the other building, and I'll show a plot of that in a moment. But just slightly before we finish, with this very awkward little triangle, this is the metalled surface here of the path. This is the Norman ashlar wall, and we had this little triangle. So we decided to excavate down in this little awkward space to see if we could see some earlier phases of this stone wall. And we identified what we thought at first was the foundations of it. But when we uncovered enough of it, we realized it wasn't on quite the perfect alignment. It's a very odd, very friable stone that outcrops in places. It's exactly the same material that they used to outline the kist in the bowl hole. And what we got was another earlier phase of stone wall. So we're looking at we're looking at basically two phases of stone wall that predate the 12th century chapel. And we think that this is probably part of an original perimeter defense of the inner ward. So this looks very like we've got an early medieval stone fortress replaced in stone again in the Norman period and then expanded in a slightly later period, but before the later 12th century. And just at the limit of excavation, which is basically how far a student lying on their stomach can reach down into the ground, at the base of that little triangle, we uncovered some human bone, which turns out to be what we appear to be fragments of an elderly lady who apparently lived quite a hard life. So that's really all we know about this. We don't know where this burial was disturbed from. There is a possibility the bones were partially articulated when they were redeposited, but they're basically dumped into an infill. So there may be a fascinating little story here. I'm sure Bernard Cornwell could make much of it, but this seems to have been a disturbed burial that's basically been dumped in and around the late 12th century in the infill here. So it's one of those little surprises that archaeology just throws up for you. And before I go and do a very quick pressy of the Westboard, this is the original early wall that we found underneath the chapel. You can see it just poking out here on the other side of the stone foundation. That's the right angled corner there where it turns around. And in that little area here is where those two stones that we identified in the rubble foundation, and they all aligned to produce a rectangular building, distinctly off the east-west alignment, but underneath the 12th century church. So we think that this is likely an Anglo-Saxon period stone building. Whether this is part of or something to do with the Church of St. Peter that Oswald's remains were stored in, or whether that lies elsewhere in the world, we can't be certain, but it's a fascinating little structure. And it was built right up against the perimeter wall, because this is the wall with the two phases of earlier material that aligns there. So we think the original west wall, inner ward wall, runs along here and turns somewhere in this area. And then it was extended to be a little bit of a wider space sometime in the 12th century. A relatively small area, but it packs an awful lot of interesting archaeology in. And when we get a proper handle on the post-ex for the West Ward, if we've got the confidence to do so, it would be really nice to go and do a little bit more archaeological work here in the future. Right, very quickly, we're still doing this. I'll go over our two main excavations in the West Ward. Very quickly, Trench 1 here, and then a little bit about Trench 3, which is basically our attempt to finish the work that Hope Taylor had started. Right up at this northern tip, there is an entrance that extends down through a cleft in the rock, which in the later Middle Ages is a postern gate. But we have documentary evidence that suggests that this is the original entrance to the fortress in the early medieval period. So we wanted to have a look and see if we could identify defences and such like. And understand those better. This is a big piece of the 12th century perimeter wall that still survives. The rest of it is basically 1920s garden wall which stops people falling down into the beach from the inner ward. And we've got part of the 12th, 13th century, perimeter wall here from the medieval castle. And you can see where we've piled a load of sandbags in here because we were about to strip this area off. So that was health and safety. We're also in the middle of about reevaluating Hope Taylor's cutting D at this point. So that's the gate cleft itself. That's the St. Oswald's Wood Gate entrance. And we found a stone rubble foundation predating the later medieval defences running just inside. And we also found two rectilinear slots, which appear to be early buildings. And what we seem to have is, this is the gate entrance. The medieval wall as it exists today is built partly over the break of slope. So we think that this rubble foundation here, which parallels it, is possibly the back wall of a box rampart, a timber phase of defense built onto a rubble foundation. It's cut by a corn drying kiln. And then it has 12th century masonry dug into the top of that corn dryer. And inside of it, not aligned with the external wall, but with the actual gate cleft itself, we have two structures. One is a narrow, thin, I'll outline it here, timber wall, which goes down there. This may be the back edge of it here, but it was unfortunately very badly disturbed by rabbits. So we weren't 100% certain. So we've got three certain walls of a timber hall, possibly the fourth. And it looks like a very substantial timber hall, basically dominating the entrance. So our best interpretation is that we're looking at perhaps a gate wards hall, whoever's controlling access to the royal palace probably lives here. And within it, we have a broader, flatter bottomed robber cut for what we think is a stone wall. One of the stone blocks survives there, two more here. So we think we've got a timber hall replaced in stone and all robbed out before the 12th century. So probably two phases of Anglo-Saxon buildings that dominate and control the entrance. And finally, if we go and have a quick look at Trench 3, which is out in the main part of the West Ward, our excavation, this is Hope Taylor's 1970s excavations either side of a bulk which he left in. So it's a bit of an L-shaped trench in a way. We have a vast midden deposit, which is, runs from about the 12th century right through the 15th century. When you get back into the sort of 10th, 11th century period, we found what turns out we thought originally was a hearth, but it wasn't directly fired. We found what we think now is a rubble foundation for a doorway. And then spreading either side of it, we had vast amounts of ash and charcoal. A big burning event, which is a linear burning event. So our best interpretation is that we've got a big timber hall here, which is burned down. The bit we've seen is there. So we're looking at a very substantial timber structure, probably vaguely aligned with the external wall. And that's our 10th and 11th century phase of Bamburgh West Ward. Beneath that, in the 9th century, and it's really quite well dated because we've got about 70 coins from the same surface, we've got a rubble foundation for what's not much more sophisticated than a shed, lots of hammer scale, lots of metal finds in this area. We think this is a smithy. Again, you can see it here. It doesn't show up particularly well on this photo, but you can see there are internal floor surfaces that are slightly different coloured. There's a pebble path running parallel to it. And gaps which we think are entrances, at least two of them show ash and charcoal spilling out through them. So we think this is a smithy where they're doing metalworking, probably making arms and armor for the royal court. And beneath that, the layer earlier, we have basically a cobble courtyard surface, off which we've got a beautiful little mount of a bird, which we probably see in the finds later, which seems to be dated to the 8th century. Our radiocarbon date from directly beneath this is middle to late 7th century. And we've got a long hearth surviving in fragments up here. And there's kind of an edge along there, which when it wets and dries shows a stain. So we think there's a timber groundstanding hall with an internal hearth here, probably other structures on this side. So we think that this is another earlier phase of industrial activity of buildings built around a courtyard area. And this area here is Hope Taylor's mortar mixer. And in our final little seasons of excavation, we've gotten to the lowest point we've managed so far. The mortar mixer is just off the photograph. That's the cobble yard surface from the 7th century. We were two phases at least earlier. And we found this curving rubble foundation, which continued being outlined in what are dark, basically floor surfaces within a building. It took a while for the penny to drop. We had to unearth quite a bit of it, but we suddenly realized we're looking at a roundhouse. Because we're two phases earlier than the 7th century, we don't think we're early enough to be Iron Age, so it's probably a Romano-British period of occupation, but it's the first time we've seen physical structures from that period. And now we have a stain of where one of these blocks had been robbed out there. So we're looking at, if you can see the curvature coming through here, and it's outlined in these full surfaces. So it's quite a substantial roundhouse. We think probably 9 to 10 meters in diameter. But the really interesting thing about this is that we've seen pottery, we've got radiocarbon dates, we've got animal bone from these Roman and pre-Roman occupation layers. But this is the first time we've seen a building. And we're way down in the west ward here. So we're in the lower status part of the fortress. So if there were big roundhouses down here, the likelihood is there must be more up on the summit of the hill in the heart of the fortress. So this is our first real indication that Bamburgh in this period is full of buildings. So we've got a basically as a central place, going back into the Roman and probably the pre-Roman Iron Age, still very important site at that time. So as an end to the West Ward excavations, that was a real bonus, and it's caused quite a little bit of excitement. So it was a very exciting way to end what turned out to be a marathon dig. And now we just have the process of many years of interpreting and writing it all up.
Thanks, Graham. That's awesome. So we've got a few questions in the Q&A. The first couple kind of refer to the inner ward discussion. So Jennifer has asked, was there a radiocarbon date for the bones of the lady dumped in the little triangle area?
We did. It told us what we expected beforehand. The problem is that unless you've got lots of carbon dates that you can sort of stack and interpret, you get a reasonably broad idea. So I think, the top of my head, I don't know if Joe remembers better than I do from when we wrote the report. I think they centered around the 12th century. So they were fairly consistent with the backfill date.
It was definitely not early medieval. I think it was around the construction time.
We thought that at the very earliest, this individual could be late 11th. So we're looking at someone assuming that Sarah was right, and a couple of the knee joint may have had some ligaments still, and it's a bit gruesome, but the knee joints may have had the odd ligament attached when the burial was disturbed, because clearly that this wasn't a burial, this was remains that had been disturbed being dumped. That if there was a little bit of still stuff attaching, then the death and the decomposition hadn't completely by the time it was disturbed, so presumably that's reasonably close to the extension of the ward and the building of the new chapel in the later 12th century.
Another question from Linda. She's put, isn't the early medieval date for the burial ground evidence that there must have been an early medieval castle building on the site?
Well, we do have, obviously we're very lucky that we have a cemetery site that also matches the same date range as some of our occupation layers. I didn't mention it in the quick run through, but our best estimate of the date of the mortar mixer is probably around the 8th century. It might just be the very end of the 7th. We know from Bede that the mortar and stone architecture starts being used for the impressive churches in the Tyne Valley at the end of the 7th century. So the likelihood is the kings then acquire this technology and use it for their own purposes. So we think that certainly Bede tells us about a timber fortress that Pendu attempted to burn around the middle of the 7th century. And at some point, probably vaguely contemporary with the mortar mixer, we think because of what we see in the inner ward and a little bit of clue in trench one on the opposite side of the fortress, I think by the at some point in the 7th, in the 8th, 9th century, a timber fortress is replaced in stone. So yes, and the burial ground basically spans this time period from timber to stone fortress. So yeah, there would have been a timber palace replaced in stone contemporary to the burial ground.
And I think you've pretty much answered Linda's follow-up question there, so that's brilliant. I think just looking at time, we'll move on from the Q&A, but you can always put some other questions in there. And I think we're just going to move on to the section that looks at the artefacts, which I'm going to run through at pace just to keep us on track. And Graham's going to chip in, hopefully, as we go along as well. Can you see that, Graham?
It hasn't appeared yet. Oh, there we go. It's just a little lag.
Awesome. So we have, as I mentioned already, something like 12,000 small finds. And if you're not aware of what a small find is, it's something that's particularly of interest, something that might be important for dating a context or a feature, or something that's quite unique and special. And then we also have bulk finds. And as I mentioned before, we have rooms and rooms of bulk finds at Bamburgh, particularly animal bone. But this includes things like shell, pottery, particularly from the kind of medieval period onwards. As pottery becomes less common in the early medieval, we start small finding that. So what we thought would be fun to do, just to kind of finish off, is look at some of the our particular favourite small finds from the Bamburgh Research Project excavation. But there are some really cool finds from the Hope Taylor dig that we thought we'd have a quick look at first. And on your screen at the moment is the Hope Taylor finds, which is the Bamburgh Beast, which is a particularly cool find. It's gold, as you can see, and we have at the at Bamburgh found some examples ourselves during our excavations. We had somebody come and have a look at these a couple of years ago, and they thought this particular piece was very reminiscent of the pieces from the Staffordshire Hoard, and we're looking at probably the 7th or 8th century. And this is a kind of a zoomorphic beast. We've never quite figured out what it is. I think some people suggested it was an elephant, which seems about a bit outrageous. I don't know if Grimmer has any thoughts on what it might be.
I can see if you imagine that there was a trunk heading from a head there. I guess it's one of these zoomorphic designs that may have started out as something but take on a life of their own. So I think it's almost like a magic eye thing. It's what you perceive it as.
Awesome. Right, so we'll move on, and this is a particularly exciting bunch of objects, if my screen wants to work. Here we go. So these are, this is a sword and an axe head that was found under, is it Brian Hope Taylor's bed, I believe, Graham?
We're not sure exactly where. I think that rumour started by someone else. What we do know is that when Brian Hope Taylor died, all the artefacts and the records were rescued, and we went to see them up in the Scottish Royal Commission. And basically, the swords and the axe were in a suitcase, a very battered suitcase, wrapped in a pair of curtains, still with the Bamburgh soil attached to them. And Phil Wood and I instantly recognised the soil. And these were the swords that he'd referenced in one of his few publications from 1960 as coming from his trial trench one. So it was a very exciting moment.
Brilliant. And we actually sent these for analysis at the Royal Armouries, I believe, and they undertook quite a bit of conservation. And one of the brilliant things we found through X-ray is that this is six pattern welded sword, Graham?
Yeah, it's six strand pattern welded. And the other one is either two or four, depending on which expert looks at the X-ray.
So this makes it very, very special. There's very few examples like this in Britain, and it would have taken some skill to produce. So we're looking at very high status material here. And the other thing I wanted to flag up, and this is not actually a Hope Taylor find, this is an antiquarian find as they were reworking the castle interior, is a piece of early medieval sculpture. This is a photograph from the corpus of Anglo-Saxon stone sculpture. And we believe, based on their interpretation, that this may actually be part of a frith stool, which is an early version potentially of a throne. And we had a few years ago, was it 2010, Graham, when we had a go at reproducing this?
It would be, yes.
And have a lovely picture here. So I don't know if you can see my cursor, but we took the dimensions of this area here and replicated what we thought, based on the size of a 6 foot male, that the stool would look like. And we also added the Bamburgh Beast here, but it gives us a really good impression of what this would have looked like, at least this section here, before it was eroded. Unfortunately, it's the only piece we found, but it does suggest that we're looking at a very high status site, because these crop up at particularly monastic sites in Northumberland across the county. And this particular type is highly decorative, so it's probably an earlier example. And now we're going to move on to the Bamburgh Research Project finds. Now, I found this quite difficult because this is my personal interpretation of our top 10. Graham might argue the toss here, and I'm sure the people who have been involved in the project will be cringing at some of the things I've chosen. And I did promise you a top 10, but I've actually done a top 9 with a kind of let's have a look at some of the other material for our 10th example. So we have a lot of work to do at the Bamburgh Research Project, because for every day that we excavate, we anticipate that we have to do 3 days of post-ex. And that takes time and money. But thankfully, we've been really lucky with our funding grants, and we've worked through a lot of our metal work. We've got some excellent finds, and I just wanted to show you some of the metalwork that's been conserved, particularly from the West Ward. This is an example of shears, and we've sent these off for conservation. We've had x-rays done, then we assess which ones need conserving, and you can see the shears here before conservation and an example of them after conservation. And thanks to funding from the Royal Archaeological Institute and the Society of Antiquaries over the last few years, we've been able to actually analyse and conserve all our early medieval metalwork from the West Ward. And I've just pulled out a few of the before and after shots from the really exciting pieces that we have. A particular favourite here is an early medieval firelighter. We've got a blade edge here, an arrowhead, a copper alloy, belt buckle end, and a mystery object that we believe is early medieval, but the conservator and the metalwork analysis suggested, you know, it could be anywhere from the early medieval through to the high medieval, and they don't have a clue what it is. And we have quite a few objects like that, one of which has made its way into the top 10, and I'd like your thoughts on that. We have lots of worked bone at Bamburgh, ranging from kind of the early medieval period right through to the high medieval. This is a red deer. Red deer tusk worked. Well, this suggests it's either a practice piece or a piece that never got finished. We've got other examples of worked bone here, and we've got this beautiful early medieval pendant, which is particularly unusual because from this period they're usually made of metal and occasionally jet. But analysis has suggested that this is early medieval and quite unique. We also have lots and lots and lots of pottery. I've washed quite a large portion of it, so I should know. But I pulled out a few interesting bits and bobs. As I mentioned already, a lot of our medieval pottery goes into bulk fine just because there is so much of it. And a lot of it actually comes from midden deposits, which are quite run from the 12th to 15th century. But occasionally we do have bits of interesting pottery. I nearly put a picture of you here, Graham, examining this piece of early medieval pottery, although we thought potentially it could be a crucible as well. I don't know if you've got anything to say on that.
Oh, I don't remember that one very well.
Oh, sorry, putting you on the spot there.
Stay silent.
And then we've also got evidence of prehistoric pottery here. And Graham did mention some of the Roman material. This is a particularly nice piece of Samian ware. But up until the very latter stages of the project, we were finding Roman material, but it was all in disturbed context. So this came from a pit feature excavated into the early medieval layers, but was probably brought up from those earlier deposits. But we do get quite a lot of Roman material cropping up. Some of it's kind of African slipware, others is the Samian that you can see on the screen there. And then let's move on. And I also wanted to bring your attention to some of the glass that we find. Typically, it's actually Roman glass. And you can see some examples here. We've got a bead and parts of two glass bracelets here. We very rarely find anything early medieval, though, although I do believe we've had a few small beads along the way.
There were one or two of them in the bowl hole, just little personal items, and a couple of matching ones from Trench 3, but not a huge amount.
So that's the typical kind of material culture we find as small finds. And now I'm going to move into our kind of countdown. You may find some of these a little bit odd, and I'm going to start with hammer scale. Graham mentioned it very, very briefly, and this is actually a terrible quality picture that I've added here, so I do apologise. But throughout our Trench 3, the West Ward Trench 3 with the metalworking building, we have these patches of burning all over the trench, really. So we thought it would be an excellent idea to undertake hammer scale sampling. Now, hammer scale is created during the forging process, and we've created some modern hammer scale, probably on the Bamburgh barbecue one evening, and this is what you can see here. And in this element here, you can see we've got a 1 by 1 meter drawing frame, but we're actually taking 20 centimeter by 20 centimeter samples. And the purpose of which is to find flake hammer scale. and spheroidal hammer scale, which are created at high temperatures during the forging process. And because we believe we've got this metal working building, this is going to be really, really exciting for us. And as you can see here, and this is the map of bench three, and you can see each of those 1 meter squares has been sampled. And this is our metal working building here with the burnt spread. Now, I hate to say this, we don't actually have the results of this. So this is why it's at number nine, but the potential to actually map the forging space and the metal working in this area is significantly improved due to hammer scale. And that's why I thought it was worth a spot on the top 10/9. This is a jet crucifix, which came out of the Midden deposit that Graham mentioned. It dates to the 12th to the 15th century. It's really unusual. We haven't had anything like that, particularly with it being made out of jet. And we were a bit stuck with it. We didn't really quite understand the date or what it would have looked like whole. But a few years ago, one of the colleges at Cambridge, I believe it was St. John's College, was excavated. And underneath there, they found 400 burials from a hospital. And they actually found a very, very similar example to our 12th to 15th century jet crucifix. So we were very excited about this. And I've put the link in here for you to have a look at it if you're interested. But it's probably our only high medieval example that's made it into the top 10. And that's probably my bias because I am an early medievalist. So I do apologise to those out there who really like it. And then the Bamburgh bird that Graham mentioned. Graham, do you want to mention how it was discovered? Because I wasn't actually there for this one.
It was basically, we were working our way through the ash in Midden deposits directly under the metalworking building. And we basically put a long thin trench down to try and get an idea of what we were heading towards. And we found we had a cobbled surface. And really within about 4 meters, 3-4 meters of Hope Taylor's Trench 1, at that edge, we found this tiny little fragment of copper alloy, which even when it came out of the ground, unlike iron, which obviously is very corroded, you could see immediately that there was a pattern on it. We thought it was a dragon originally, but it turns out to be a bird. So yeah, that was a very, very, Graham Dixon, the supervisor of the trench at the time, tries to claim it, as does Harry, who I think actually did find it at the point of his trial, one of his assistants. So I think once people start disputing who found something, you know you've got a good find.
Brilliant. So we sent this, we sent pictures of this to try and get some perspective on what it might be. Like I say, we thought it was a dragon to begin with, but it's clearly a zoomorphic bird. We were very excited to hear back that there are no direct parallels for this. There are similar examples from the 7th to 8th century, but nothing specifically that would reference this. We do know that later examples evolve, and we can find them on examples like the Sutton Hoo helmet and the Hallerton helmet as well. But it was an exciting find, and we still don't really know the date, but we can date it by context rather than by association. One of my particular favourites for all those pottery specialists out there is our very own Bamburghware. So this is a form of pottery that isn't found anywhere else in the UK. So we believe it's locally made. And certainly for our finds assemblage and pottery assemblage that's been explored, I think it makes up something like 24% of all the pottery found on the site. And it dates to around the 12th to 14th century. We did have a go at reconstructing some of it, so you get a little bit of a vibe about how it might feel. So we've got a large vessel here with a rib side. So I think that deserves to be in our top 10 purely because it is Bamburghware and it's not found anywhere else. Graham, do you have any more information about that one to share?
I think that there's a fair bit of it being found in a few adjacent sites now. I think some of it came out at an excavation at Embleton, a little bit to the south. And I think slightly inland as well, there's been one or two bits and bobs. And during a couple of interventions in the village itself, we found it there. But it does seem to be very focused on our little corner of Northumberland. I think Jenny Fawn was going to try and see if she'd ever identified any on Lindisfarne. But I'm not sure if anyone ever looked. But it's very different. It has a very flat, solid base, and then it seems to rise up and become quite thin. and it has big, thick, chunky inclusions. So it's very distinctive stuff. Once you see it, you really get your eye into it. We've never found a complete one, though. We've got a very nice base. So who knows what's hidden in that vast bulk finds that might piece together about it. But yeah, it's a nice little bit because it seems to be Bamburgh's own.
Brilliant. Thanks, Graham. Okay, now this is a bit of an odd one. Graham didn't even remember it when I mentioned it to him, which is disappointing because this is actually my favourite object ever excavated at Bamburgh. It's actually associated with our metalworking building that we discussed. It's a very flat piece of stone with two deliberate perforations in, so it's obviously attached to something, whether it was nailed or sewn into something. And it's, hopefully you can see here, it's got some quite deliberate markings on it. But everybody we've shown it to really doesn't have a clue as to what it is, although some have suggested it's some sort of, it might be a curse or it might be something odd like that, but nobody has any answers. So part of my reason for sharing it is hoping that maybe in the chat you guys could give me some ideas about what you might think it is. And feel free to be wacky with it. I'm up for any and anything in terms of interpretation. But I just think it's one of those really enigmatic objects that we found at Bamburgh that we don't really have an interpretation for. And I'm going to quickly move on to another one, although Graham's done a little bit more research on this. And I think Graham's going to just tell you a little bit more about this one. And this is a gaming board.
Yeah, this is one of my favourites because I actually found this. When you're one of the directors, you rarely get to dig all that much. So you don't really find much yourself. But this was found when we reevaluated Hope Taylor's Trial Trench 1. So we can very narrowly date it between the Bronze Age and the modern, because that's the whole sequence of the trench. There are a series of, a series of flags, which I think are broadly contemporary with our big yard surface. And it may be that it's reused as that. But basically it had been pulled out of the backfill and was being discarded when I realized there were some weird lines on it. And it turns out that you can see we've got one edge where it stops, and then you've got lots and lots of these incised lines that make multiple little squares. And I thought it was some form of gaming board, one of the sort of taffle board games, something like that. I did manage to find an expert who I emailed a photograph to, and he was very kind enough to apply. He suggested that it may, because of the sheer number of squares, he thinks it's not a taffle. He thinks, and I think this is his pet theory, because there were at least one, possibly two other examples in Europe. He thinks it's a lost game that has a very large number of squares on it. And that there was an example from the Balkans that he was currently working on, and he was chasing down rumors that something similar had been found in Sweden, presumably from an early medieval deposit. And he thought it was in use from around the Iron Age into the early medieval period as a game. So yeah, we need to, we're partway through writing up that Hope Taylor Trench 1, our Trench 8. So I will, if he's kind enough to apply again, I will see what he's found out that's new about it. But it's very personal little piece, and because it's such a happenstance find. And we don't have a lot of gaming stuff other than dice. It's one of my little favorite features.
Thanks, Graham. And just talking about Trench 8, good segue there. So this is our re-excavation of Trench 8, which I think was around 2006, if memory serves. And one of the best things that we found was actually, while re-excavating it, was Hope Taylor's tags still stuck in the section side. And this is one of the examples here, but it really gave us an insight into how he excavated his trenches, how he was recording his material, and it allowed us to kind of pinpoint where some of the key finds came from as well. I remember being in Trench 8, but I don't know if Graham, if you've got any memories as the director at the time.
Yes, it was fascinating. I mean, we managed to do our own little mini excavation down the bulk, and right at the base of that, just above the glacial, we've recently got our earliest ever radiocarbon date, which was 9th century BC. But yes, what we were really looking for was a nice little tag saying "Here be swords," because that's what we were really fascinated. We wanted to know exactly where the swords come from, because we know they're from this trench. But luckily, when we finally get our hands on Hope Taylor's site records, that's that actual section with the ranging rod leaning against it he drew in great detail and wonderfully neatly marked in pencil with an X marks the spot. And the early medieval context is the sword and the axe. So we actually, we were hoping to identify where these swords and axe came from, but ultimately Hope Taylor had already recorded it.
Brill, thanks, Graham. Okay, moving on to our second piece, which is our Bamburgh Gold Mount. Now, everybody likes a shiny find, but that's not really why it ended up here. But just to give you a sense, this is very, very small. I think it's about, was it 3 centimetres across? I think I do have one with a scale on in a moment. But the reason I put this at number two is how it was found. So just show you some pictures. So we found this during our environmental sampling, and that's something that we do quite a lot across all our sites, where we take samples of soil and then we put them through the flotation system, which you can see here. And then that's dried out, the material that's left, and then it's sorted through. And this little object here came from our environmental sampling. And unless you're really, really into environmental processing, it can be quite a tedious job. So I was just so pleased on the day for Constance, who's here, although you can't see it in her hand, to find something so amazing in the environmental sampling tubs. And it just demonstrates how important it is to undertake this type of sampling, because little tiny, tiny objects like this can be lost. And over the course of that season and the season after, we actually found a number of small gold objects. So these are the examples here. And this is a little stud, which we believe would have had some sort of either precious stone or glass element in there. And this is millimetres. So you can see how small they are. So to spot them in the trench would be incredibly difficult. But to find them in the environmental sampling is particularly exciting, but just demonstrates the worth of looking at things at small scale as well. And finally, the Stiker hoard, which is what I think is our number one find. I don't know, Graham, do you agree?
It's really nice bit of dating evidence, and it comes with a lot of other bits of information, because it was in a cloth bag, possibly in a woven basket, and because of the corrosion product preserving the materials, we've actually got traces of textile and of the stuff that you normally don't find other than on wet sites. So yeah, it's got lots and lots of aspects to it, so that's nice. And it's also one of our indication is the late Liz Peary thought that Bamburgh might have been one of the mint sites for this early coinage. So again, it's a very close, if that's the case, and it brings us very close to being a Bamburgh feature as well. So it's not a bad choice in my opinion, no.
I'm glad to hear it. To my shame, that was the year I wasn't actually at Bamburgh, so I totally missed this. So everything's secondhand, but here you can see it being excavated. That's Graham, by the way, just if you were wondering. And John here is excavating. A lot of it came up in one piece because it was all corroded together. And if you're not sure what Stikers are, they're a Northumbrian coin. And they were the most prolific coin during the kind of, is it the 8th to 9th century, Graham? I've got some dates here.
Yeah, very late 8th, right, and through most of the 9th century. I think they're produced, I think it stops around the Viking arrival, but they may have been continued in tender for a bit longer than that.
I've got specific dates here in relation to rain, so 774 to 865. So it's quite a tight time frame. And when we find them in the trench, we found lots. I think we're nearing 300 individual Stikers in the trench now. They can be quite sad looking, quite corroded, and occasionally you get really good examples like this one here. But we found in the hoard about, I think there were 77 altogether. Because of their potential silver content, they were actually sent to the British Museum as a potential treasure find, where they also undertook analysis and conservation. So this is the X-ray of the main batch here, and these are some of the conserved coins. So we had individual ones, we had ones that were stuck together, and as Graham was talking, probably the most exciting element of it was what they were covered in. So analysis suggested that there was carbonized material on there, so there was probably some sort of burning event, and we had examples of potential kind of weaving. I don't know if you can see these here, and potential textiles on the edge carbonized here. So as Graham suggested, that they were probably in some sort of a container, grass container, with cloth around. Was the cloth first, or was the grass container?
In a cloth, either wrapped in a cloth or in a cloth bag or pouch. And they must have either been in a basket or fallen onto some form of woven matting that burned up with them.
Based on the analysis that they undertook of the actual stack of coins themselves, in terms of the moneyers and the kings depicted on either side, they were able to suggest that this hoard dated very specifically between 850 and 860, which gives us a really good kind of date for the metal working building that they were associated with as well. So that's our kind of top nine finds, plus all the other finds that we're really excited about. What I am going to do, although I'm a little bit scared about this one because I've never done it before, is I am going to send out a poll, because I'm really interested to see what you think the top finds are from Bamburgh. So bear with me, and we'll see if we can make this work. Okay, it's out there. Graham, do you have it?
I do. I can see it. Am I allowed to vote?
Yeah, go on.
Oh, Stiker Horde's doing well.
Shh.
Well,
once we've done the polling, we'll come back to your questions. Okay, we'll leave it a little bit longer. I'll let you into a secret. People don't agree with my inscribed stone object as being the number one find, but never mind. Okay, guys, so we're up to a minute now, so I'm going to end polling and then we're going to look at the results. So in first place, oh no, we'll do a top three. So in third place was the Stiker Horde, which is good. In third place was the gaming board, Graham. So you were right there. Yeah, I think they liked your tail. In second place was the Stiker Horde, and in first place was the Bamburgh bird. So we know that now. I'll share those results at a later date. That was actually 43%. So I think that was a firm favourite. And sadly, Hope Taylor Tags didn't make it on there. I can't believe that, guys. Never mind. But thank you for that. That's brilliant. And I think we'll head to some Q&A questions. So this might be for Graham and I. So just bear with me a moment. I'll just roll these down. So Jan Spencer has asked, do we have lots of post holes?
Yes, probably fewer than we should. The soil conditions at Bamburgh are a bit of a nightmare because it's basically midden and waste material building up with buildings and structures dug into each other. So when you find a nice ash surface, you get to catch a glimpse of some of the small little features that you're probably missing a lot of the time. Yeah, one of the final buildings we actually discovered on site in the final phase just before the roundhouse was two sides of a rectangular post-built structure just poking into from the limit of the trench, so built presumably against the perimeter wall, and that's probably around 7th century AD. So yeah, we do get post-hole buildings, but actually most of the structures seem to be post in trench and or sill beams on the ground, where you see an outline of something and other things that respect it rather than the building itself.
Real thanks, Graham. Sophie's got a really great question, actually. Did it feel strange taking over someone else's trenches, and did you inherit all the project plans?
Oh gosh, yes, it is kind of eerie. The opening of those doors and that, because it was really unexpected. It was really quite eerie. I think everyone who was there that day really, it sticks in their mind. Because we were all archaeologists. We'd all worked in slightly scruffy site huts. So we knew exactly what you recognize instantly. This is someone's little tea room. And this is where they've been working away on their small finds, labeling everything up, presumably because they know they're ending very soon and they want to leave it in decent order. So that was very eerie. And of course, you know, if you're interested in early medieval archaeology, from the earliest time you've heard of Hope Taylor's Yevering report, and Brian Hope Taylor is one of the, you know, the magic names of early medieval post-war archaeology. So yeah, it was quite eerie having taking over a dig like that.
I think it's
quite a responsibility as well.
It's been quite difficult for the project as well, because we are missing a lot of the excavation record. We have notebooks that describe certain things, but we can't necessarily find them in the plans and the sections. I mean, the photographs that he took are amazing. Graham spent a lot of time kind of repurposing those and trying to figure out what's what. But especially with the artifacts as well, we are missing contextual information, which is quite sad. And that's why it was so important with Trench 8, for example, to find some of the locations of the finds.
One of the things is that you're dealing with, it's not that long ago, really, because you're looking at 60s and 70s. But the way archaeology was done has changed so much that, you know, he's working in feet and inches, and he's recording not with a site grid, but with two parallel baselines off which everything are triangulated. And the two baselines don't even align with each other. They're entirely separate. So you get L 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and S 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And we finally worked out that L meant land side grid and S meant seaside grid. And then they turned out there was SX 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, because he dug through his original seaside grid. And we probably have 10% of his plans, if that, and the rest are still missing. Wonderful photography, which we're going to do our best to georeference and use in lieu of planning. But yeah, it's at every level trying to equate the finds with what's going on there and reconstruct his excavation is very challenging. I mean, it's fascinating, but it's very challenging. Every step seems to take an age.
Real, thank you. We've got some very specific questions about some of the objects. From Alan, what are the chances of finding documentary evidence of the lost game?
Oof, well, that's not, I don't know if Joe knows any more than me, but it's not my area of expertise. I'm guessing that the fact that it's lost, that there's no classical references to it, all written references to it that we know about.
Now, I think we'll only figure that one out if more examples come to fruition and we have a bit more contextual information, I think. Question from Anne, has the inscribed stone object been compared to the Vindolanda chalice? Some of the graffiti looks similar. It hasn't been compared to anything really. I think initially it was sent out to early medieval specialists to try and get a handle on that. But I think it's something we should revisit during our post-ex work. It actually reminds me quite a lot of an object found during the Starcar excavations, which is prehistoric. So had it not been found with the metalworking building, it would have been quite difficult to date. So we'll have to look at that again and come back to it. But I like some of the suggestions in the chat, so thank you for that. Another question from Rich. Inscribed object, could it be Viking? Is there anything similar found anywhere else? We do get Viking graffiti, so that might be a line to kind of follow up as well. But it's one of those that's been in the archives, and I thought it would be a good time to pull it out and get some suggestions. But we're probably looking at kind of...
One or two people have suggested that a couple of the little things may be crude runes. But I don't think we've ever been confident that they are. But certainly you can see why people would think that. But we've never really been confident that's actually what they are.
Well, thank you. A question from Eduardo. Have you been able to specifically link any of your finds to the history of Bamburgh as recounted in Bede and other historical sources?
Oh gosh, it's always very tempting to sort of link the archaeology to the historical record, and it's not always accurately the case. There is obviously one of the famous events in Bede is a siege when Penda demolishes all the timber buildings in the neighborhood, piles a giant bonfire against the rock face, and attempts to burn his way into the what was then a timber fortress. And the two obvious weak spots are what's now called the Miller's Nick next to Trench 3, and also the entrance at Oswald's Gate. And inside Oswald's Gate, quite close to where the timber wall would have stood, there's discolored boulder clay, which looks like it may have been partially fired or burned. But of course, as we know from our metalworking building, which, you know, they have fire within it, and timber buildings just burn down randomly. They're not necessarily markers of siege and such like. And there's a reference to an attack on Bamburgh in AD 991, which is entirely invisible in the archaeological record, as far as we can see. So yeah, it's very difficult to equate the written history directly to the archaeology, other than the broad brushstrokes of, we know that there's a palace site, it's, you know, timber fortress. Well, the nearest that can come, I can think of, is the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle, where it talks about Bamburgh and Ida. There's a gloss on it which says two words that people have struggled to interpret it about, a hedge, then a palisade or a palisade. But it's basically a timber fortress, which is replaced by a wall. So it's one of my little pet things, that perhaps this is just a direct reference to the fact that they're rebuilding it in stone. Because that's, I think the gloss is probably, it'll be, you know, 9th century or later. So it's possible that that's a direct reference, but even that's stretching things a little bit.
Brilliant. And our last question from David, just jumping outside the castle a little bit, any sign of habitation on the cricket pitch below the castle?
We did do a big ground penetrating radar survey out there. We know that there's a castle ditch because you can walk through it under the entranceway. And it turns out that great ditch just extends across the front of the castle in the cricket pitch area, and it's about 30 meters wide. Beyond that, towards the village, when you look at the first edition ordnance survey, there's a missing street with burgage plots from the high medieval borough. So basically the cricket pitch is dug back from a former moat through pre-existing archaeology. So we think it's been leveled there. So I think that landscaping where you step up onto the path is where they've basically taken out a great deal of material. So I think other than the ditch itself, I think the cricket pitch will be one of the more sterilized bits of archaeology in the village.
Well, that brings us to the end, I think. Thank you. We've gone well over time, so I do appreciate you, most of you, sticking here. So thank you so much for that. I hope you found it interesting. It was a very kind of quick fire whiz through 20 years worth of work. You can find out more on our website and on the Bamburgh Research blog. I do have one last poll to share, courtesy of the Festival of Archaeology, which are our kind sponsors. So I'm going to launch that now. There's three questions on there, and if you could just take a few minutes to answer them, I'm sure the guys at the Council for British Archaeology, and disclaimer here, I work there, I would really appreciate your feedback. If you do have any other questions, because with these things they always pop up, do email us or message us on one of our Facebook channels. There will be an email going out tomorrow with a few links in there which you can follow. One of them is a survey for the festival, and one is a little bit of information about our fundraising. So if you've enjoyed yourself and you've got a few spare quid, please send them our way, because we've had a tough year. But Graham, do you have anything else you want to say?
No, thank you for putting up to it. I'm not in any way surprised we've overrun. I always overrun my lectures. I'm quite notorious for it. So thanks to everyone for sticking with us, and I hope you had a good time.
Well, and apologies for the technical issues at the beginning. Half my screen froze, which meant I couldn't allow Graham into the actual session, which was slightly problematic. So I'll thank you. I'm just going to leave this going a little bit longer for the polling. But I think we're pretty much there, actually. Okay, guys, I'm going to end it there. So thank you, everybody. Take care. Have a good rest of your weekend. Bye-bye. And Graham, thank you.
Okay, pleasure.